This is the Lee Enoch Show, America's most controversial podcast, coming to you from UNT. That's the University of North Texas. And this is Lee Enoch. My partner in crime, Brock Virgin, is not here tonight. He's doing some kind of event here at UNT. It's been a blessing working with Brock these last four semesters, and he should be back next week. Pretty soon as we wrap up the semester. I think it's fitting that I do this podcast tonight solo so I can talk a little bit about the 4 years that I've done radio and podcasting. I did 2 years of live radio at a university in California. And I've done additional 2 years of podcasting for KNTU Radio here at UNT, and it's been a blessing. I've learned a lot. I learned how to persevere. This is the 60th episode of the Lee Enoch Show. There's no way I could have done all these podcasts episodes without my producer, the podcast director at KNT Radio, Ethan Leach. I want to thank Ethan. I want to thank Dan Bala. He's the station manager here at KNT Radio. I want to thank my friend Brock. I want to thank Allison, although Allison hasn't been on this semester. We did a whole semester last year with her, and it's been a blessing. And I want to thank all the guests I've had on, including Walter Block. I think we had him on 6 times. Travis Dickinson, Seth. We've had Reverend Seth on here. We've had Casey Lopez. We've had so many people, and all their names have escaped me by now, but it's just been a blessing. 60 episodes. This is the 60th episode of the Lee Enoch Show, America's most controversial podcast. So we'll talk a little bit about NCAA basketball, as has been our tradition over the last couple of years, talk about sports. I keep up with sports. I'm not a sports expert like Brock, but I do keep up with it. There's been some major upsets. A small university in southeastern Michigan, Oakland, not Oakland, California, but the Oakland Oaks, in Rochester, Michigan, upset Kentucky with a massive upset. And a graduate senior get 10 three-pointers. I think all together he scored 32 points, but 10 of them, 10 three-pointers. At least got 30 points of those 32 points, so he hit 2 free throws. There's some teams that are still in it. Connecticut looks really strong. The University of Houston, University of North Carolina, Duke is still in it. So one thing I wanted to say is that the Coach Hurley for the University of Connecticut, who won a national championship last year, he's a brother of Bobby Hurley, and their father was a famous high school basketball coach, I think, in New Jersey. But Coach Hurley Dan Hurley of the University of Connecticut, mentioned that it was basically an injustice that only 3 teams from the Big East Conference are still that made it to the NCAAs. Teams like St. John's. St. John's went through a brutal schedule. They won 20 games and didn't make the playoffs. And then Indiana State didn't make it. There were several teams that seemed like they deserved to be in the NCAA playoffs. So that was a big problem. Well, an issue in basketball, college basketball, Kim Mulkey, the coach of LSU, she's been very controversial over the years. I guess she had a kind of a sketchy relationship with her former player at Baylor, Brittany Griner, who was detained in Russia last year for marijuana use. Evidently, there is a Washington Post sports writer, a journalist for the Washington Post, is evidently going to write a hit piece, or is in the process of publishing a hit piece on Kim Mulkey. She had a major press conference basically saying it's a hit piece, and that if there's any slander or misrepresentation of her, she's going to sue for defamation. So we'll see what happens there. But she called that sports writer sleazy, dishonest, using dishonest methods to try to get bad publicity on her. So, you know, there's a lot of issues like that going on in the news today. Something that's a news item that's broke in the last week or so is this thing with Ohtani, the Los Angeles Dodgers superstar pitcher and batter. You know, in the history of baseball, there have been very few players that could hit legitimately and pitch legitimately. I'm mindful of Babe Ruth, the famous New York Yankee slugger who hit 60 home runs in the 1927 season. Well, before Babe Ruth was a great hitter and broke all kind of records for the Yankees as a slugger, they won several World Series. And that 1927 team with Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig was considered one of the greatest teams of all time. But before he was a batter, a full-time batter, he was a pitcher for the Boston Red Sox. And I think he won two or three World Series for the Red Sox, the last being, I think, in 1918. And then Red Sox famously or infamously traded Babe Ruth to the Yankees. The problem with that they didn't win a World Series again, I think, all the way to 2004. 100 years almost passed, you know, 90 years or whatever passed from the time that the last time the Red Sox won the World Series, but when they had Babe Ruth, and then the Red Sox sold Babe Ruth to the Yankees for, I think, $100,000, and then something to do with like some kind of production, like a play or something like that on Broadway. But Babe Ruth was the last superstar batter and pitcher. Now, about 20 years ago, the St. Louis Cardinals had Rick Ankle. I forget how to really pronounce his name, but he was a pitcher for St. Louis who's doing pretty good. He had a good rookie year. I think he pitched in a World Series for them. And then he famously lost his control and was out of baseball. I mean, he just could not get the ball over the plate. And then he went to the minor leagues because he was a good hitting pitcher. And he went to the minor leagues and he resurfaced in Major League Baseball as a hitter. Now, unfortunately, that player, he was popped for steroids or human growth hormone. And his time as a batter in Major League Baseball was tainted by his pretty evident human growth hormone intake. A really sad thing, but there's been very few pitchers in the history of Major League Baseball that were good hitters. There was a good hitting pitcher, Walter Johnson, famous pitcher for the Washington Senators, was a good hitter. There was a guy in the Detroit Tigers who hit pretty well as a pitcher, but nobody has been like Babe Ruth, except until recently this Ohtani that pitched for the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim last 5 years or so. He won the MVP twice for the Angels. Just a great hitter, great all-around player, but also a great pitcher. But anyways, Ohtani had to have a press conference recently because the news broke last week that his interpreter, now remember he's from Japan, and I don't think he speaks English very well. So Ohtani, basically the interpreter, the first story that came out was that Ohtani had covered his interpreter's gambling debts. I guess there was some kind of bookie or something like that that his interpreter was working with and lost millions of dollars. And at first, his interpreter said that Ohtani covered his gambling debts, that he wasn't in. Ohtani wasn't involved in betting on teams or something of that nature. And remember, Ohtani has a $700 million contract for 10 years. The greatest sports contract in the history of America. Well, he's not American, but for American team is Ohtani. He, Shohei Ohtani for the Los Angeles Dodgers is remarkable. But then the story changed. Basically, he had a press conference yesterday in which he said that his interpreter stole that money and he was dishonest. He lied about what was going on. A diametrically different story than what the interpreter said and what the news is that first happened. So there's a lot of suspicion that Ohtani may be not giving the truth of what really happened. Who knows? There's going to be a massive investigation about it. We'll see. We'll see. Major League Baseball first game of the season getting ready to occur here in a few days. And just go over some teams real quick here. So, Gerrit Cole, the famous pitcher for the New York Yankees, I think he has like a $350 million contract. He's hurt. We talked about this last week, Brock and I. He's hurt. And out into at least June. Man, the Yankees weren't expecting that their star ace pitcher is out for half the season. But things happen. So the New York Yankees have been an enigma. They had a horrible season last year where I think they won, they barely were over 500. I think they won 82-80. Man, they've had some issues of players not stepping up and fulfilling their potential, fulfilling their contracts, in that they've just had some mediocre play, or less than mediocre, really poor play. They signed a player a few years ago, this guy, Giancarlo Stanton, just has played miserably for the Yankees the last few years. Just miserable. And it's been a just horrible, horrible situation. Just not fulfilling his potential. And so they've got three superstar players in their batting lineup. They've got Stanton, who I just mentioned. They've got Juan Soto, who they picked up in a trade. And they've got Aaron Judge. Now, Aaron Judge is a 6'7", 6'8", superstar center fielder for the New York Yankees. Was kind of hurt last year, but still hit 37 home runs. But the year before that, he hit 63 home runs for the Yankees. He won the MVP. He's the captain of the Yankees. I think their first captain since Derek Jeter, the famous shortstop for the New York Yankees. Just an amazing player. So with Stanton, Soto, and Aaron Judge, the Yankees, if they, those guys can just play up to their potential and average 30, 35 home runs and 100 RBIs, they should at least make a wild card playoff spot. Now, the Baltimore Orioles look good again this year. Baltimore's built their team from their farm club. They were a horrible team for a number of years, and they built their team up from the farm club. And Baltimore looks good. Toronto should threaten. Also, Tampa Bay Rays look good. Those are some powerful teams. The Detroit Tigers look horrible. Red Sox, surprisingly, look bad. They look like they're going to be last in their division, which is a shock, because over the last 20 years or so, the Red Sox have usually had a really good team. They've kind of fallen on hard times. Well, especially when they lose people like Mookie Bettis to the Dodgers. Now, speaking of the Dodgers, oh my gosh, the Los Angeles Dodgers, they have unlimited money, so they just go out and get all the players they want. Their team is stacked. Another team that's stacked is the Philadelphia Phillies. I'm going to be honest with you. I love the Philadelphia Phillies. We mentioned Kyle Schwarber last week, but also we've just got some great, great players. That team, Bryce Harper, a famous prodigy player, has been in the league now for about 10 years, and he's a warrior. Yes, he makes a lot of money. He's kind of controversial, but that guy plays his heart out. I guess he is permanently going over to first base now. He was a very good outfielder, but I think he's really banged up, and I think has hurt his arm. He had to have Tommy John surgery. But the Philadelphia Phillies look pretty good. They were stacked. I would not be surprised if Philadelphia didn't make a run for the World Series. Dodgers always look good. Dodgers have a built-in advantage of their unlimited payroll. I would be disappointed if the Dodgers did not make the World Series. Now, a team that man has just fallen on hard times is the angels. Wow, what a horrible, there's no wonder why Otani left that team. Just a sad, sad situation. But anyways, that's my knowledge of baseball. I'm rooting for the Philadelphia Phillies to do something pretty big. And, you know, I've always been pretty high on the Yankees. We'll see what happens there. Before we transition to the main topic today, because this Sunday is Easter, and we're going to talk about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I've made no apology over the last four semesters, the last year. I've had several guests, several Anglican scholars on my show. And contrary to the opinion of some people, they have called me like a secular conservative. Nothing could be further from the truth. First of all, I don't even know if I'd consider myself a conservative. I have very libertarian views. I want the least amount of government interference in our personal lives. I live by the adage that the best government is the least amount of government. That government is corrupt, bankrupt, always out for our money, always out to enrich the politicians that fill those congressional and Senate seats. I have no confidence in the political system in the United States. I don't support any government. I don't support any party anymore. No politicians. I'm completely skeptical. Politics, the political system in the United States is broken. So I don't have any political views to really argue for, except I want the least amount of government interference in my personal life possible. I'll vote accordingly. I'm definitely vigorously opposed to the Democratic Party. The Democrats, I don't support their endless attacks on Trump. But I'll be truthful with you. I was pretty supportive of Trump before January 6th, in full disclosure. But I did not like the January 6th thing, and I didn't like Trump's response. Now, did I think there were some foolishness that happened with the bank with the ballots? The biggest thing for me was all the absentee ballots. I had a problem with that. I think the Democrats took advantage of the occasion of the coronavirus and had a pretty lax absentee ballot situation. I don't know who's going to win the election. I hope it's not Joe Biden. Not making any endorsement of anybody. I don't like Joe Biden at all. I don't like the Democratic Party. I'm pro-life. Very capitalistic. But I'm definitely not a person. I just don't want any government interference in my personal life. And I want us to be able to make as much money and keep as much money as we possibly can. I think Joe Biden is corrupt. I think Joe Biden has, inflation in the United States is horrible. The whole thing about inflation, man, and groceries are 25-30% higher under Joe Biden than Trump. Hey, I think Trump makes a lot of controversial statements. He does some controversial things, but the economy just seemed like it was way better under Donald Trump than Joe Biden. People say, oh, Trump didn't know what he's doing. He was a buffoon in there, but I think he did a lot better than, despite all the idiotic stuff of the Russian collusion hoax and all these things. I think Donald Trump was a better president than Joe Biden. I'll just put it that way. We'll see what happens. I don't know if Trump's going to be in jail by the time the fall elections take place or not. He's got all these indictments against him. You know, interesting, his stock, Donald Trump's social media company, had an estimated market value of nearly $8 billion today. The stock just went up, went public. It's already worth $8 billion. One thing about Donald, he can be out one day, back on top the next day. Speaking of Trump, his hush money case starts on April 15th. We'll see what happens. In other news, in Russia, there was a concert hall attacked by ISIS that killed 137 people. From what I read, that the reports is that Putin is blaming it on Ukraine. But it's kind of weird. Why would he do that? Because ISIS has publicly come out and admitted that they did it. They took full responsibility. ISIS has no connection with Ukraine whatsoever. Sometimes I think Putin is kind of unstable. An unstable dictator who kills opposition leaders. Don't like that guy. Don't like that guy at all. Well, let's get into what we're going to talk about today. In a few days, we're going to have Good Friday. We'll celebrate Good Friday. Good Friday commemorates the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the central figure of Christianity, claimed to be the Son of God. The New Testament says that he did miracles, raised the dead, healed the blind, the lame, the sick, the downtrodden. He taught about the kingdom of God. He preached the gospel of the kingdom. In the Gospel of John, chapter 1, we read, pardon me, guys, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing has come into being that has came into being. And in him was life, and the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness didn't comprehend it. And there was a man sent from God. His name was John. He was not that light, but he came to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of the will of man, nor the will of flesh, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. No man has seen God at any time, but the only begotten God, who is in the bosom of the Father, he has proclaimed him. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father but through me. So, all these verses talk about Jesus Christ of Nazareth being the Son of God who came into the world to go to the cross. On Good Friday, we talk about the cross. When Christianity says the cross, what we're talking about is the central event in the history of Christianity. In that God the Father sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sins. Upon this cross, Jesus took the sins of the world upon himself. He atoned for our sins, died there, was buried. And Christianity teaches that Jesus Christ 3 days later rose again from the dead. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Christianity's central claim is that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, God the Son, who died on the cross for our sins, was buried, and on the third day he rose again from the dead. And if we confess with our mouth Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. Jesus went about preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and he said, repent and believe in the good news. Repent, turn from our sins, and believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, this show, the Lee Enoch Show, which I've done for 4 semesters, like I mentioned previously, has not been a show that we just focused exclusively upon religious claims. But I make no apology to say that I'm a person of faith and I am a Christian. I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in the centrality of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, his death, burial, resurrection from the grave. I believe there is historical evidence also that substantiates the Bible's claim. I believe the Bible is the Word of God. I believe the Bible is inspired, inerrant in all its parts. And I believe it's historically accurate. It corresponds with the historical data of its time. I believe that the Bible is a historically accurate book. If you treat the Bible as any document of ancient history and you apply the same standards the historian would use to confirm or disconfirm the reliability of a document, we'll find that there's historical evidence to substantiate the historical narrative that the New Testament presents about Jesus Christ, that he lived 2,000 years ago, he died, and he rose again from the dead. Now, the issue of, we know that Jesus Christ died. Now, some people would say, well, we believe that Christ died, but there's no evidence for the resurrection. But here's a question I have. If Jesus Christ didn't rise again from the dead, what happened to his body? If he didn't rise from the dead, why didn't the detractors, which were many, why didn't they just produce the body of Jesus Christ and shut Christianity down once and for all? That's not how it happened. The New Testament gives this report that after Jesus Christ was crucified on Good Friday and 3 days later he rose again from the dead, that he appeared to over 500 people at once. Many of the people that saw Jesus Christ after he was crucified, they saw him rise again from the dead, or the risen Lord Jesus Christ. These were some of the same people that saw Christ crucified. Now, if Christ didn't rise again from the dead, as the New Testament says, what happened to his body? Why wasn't his body produced? And then another factor, the issue of who would die for a lie. If Christ didn't rise again from the dead, then the apostles who went out and preached that they saw Jesus Christ risen from the dead, they went out and all of them were martyred except John, and he was actually boiled in oil. He was an almost martyr, but the rest of them were martyrs. If they full well knew that Jesus Christ of Nazareth did not rise from the dead, why would they die for what in effect was a lie? What happened to the body of Jesus Christ? If Christ didn't rise again from the dead, why would the apostles of Jesus Christ, who many of them fled and stopped following Christ after he was crucified, what would cause their transformation to go back and preach to the same people that had crucified him that Christ had risen from the dead after being crucified? If Christ didn't rise again from the dead, they were liars and self-deceived, and they preached to people that Christ had risen from the dead and they hadn't seen them, and they were actually martyred for the faith upon based on a lie, which they were had no reason to do that. They had no reason to go back and preach to the very people that crucified Jesus that Jesus was risen from the dead and ultimately be martyrs if Christ did not, in fact, appear to them and, in fact, rise again from the dead. These are the factors about the resurrection of Jesus Christ that compel me to believe that Jesus Christ rose again from the dead on Easter Sunday, close to 2,000 years ago. This has been Lee Enochs, and this is the Lee Enochs Show, America's most controversial podcast. Now, one reason why it's controversial. Now, a lot of people could swear more, could be more foul. Somebody said, Lee, your show is pretty tame to have the subtitle America's most controversial podcast. But not so fast, my friends. The issue that I am talking about that's controversial is that truth is controversial. I believe in truth in a postmodern world, in a world which believes in ethical relativism, that there is no absolute truth and that society creates a standard of right or wrong based upon its needs. I think it's a bankrupt thing. I think our society is collapsing all around us. I think this is one of the worst times in American history, worst time in world civilization history, in which morality, basic decency, is really, really lost in our culture. But anyways, I believe in Jesus Christ. I am a Christian. I'm not a perfect Christian. I don't really see myself as a fundamentalist Christian. I just am generally conservative. I believe that the Bible is the Word of God. I believe in the historic creeds of the Christian faith. I believe that Jesus Christ is Son of God who died, was buried, rose again from the dead, and will return back. I believe in Apostles' Creed. I believe in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive our debts as we have forgiven those we're indebted to. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. I believe in the Apostles' Creed, the Lord's Prayer. I believe in the Nicene Creed and all the main ecumenical creeds. I attend a conservative Anglican church, part of the Anglican Church of North America diocese. I have a lot of things I need to address in my own personal life, but I love Jesus Christ. I believe that he is the Son of God and he died for me. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? According to the Bible, all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of our sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. The Bible says that after being crucified, Jesus rose again from the dead. This coming Sunday, we will celebrate Easter. This coming Friday, we'll celebrate Good Friday, the death of Jesus Christ, the death and burial of Jesus Christ. But this Sunday, we'll celebrate the glorious truth that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. The resurrection of Christ is true and is the central motif of the central theme of the Christian faith, the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ. Once again, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? And she said, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God. The Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. None of us are good. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. But Christ rose again from the dead on Easter Sunday. He is risen. He is risen indeed. And this is the central theme of the resurrection. The central theme of Easter is that Christ is risen. He is risen from the dead. He's coming back again. And I want to wish everybody a good Easter out there. Once again, summarizing the news for the week, Donald Trump's social media company has an estimated value now of nearly $8 billion as of March 26, 2024. Trump's hush money case, a federal judge has basically silenced him, and he can't speak out against judges and jurors and whatnot and lawyers on his case. The concert hall attack has been blamed on Ukraine. And Ohtani, the Los Angeles Dodger pitcher, trying to give account how his interpreter allegedly stole money from him. Kim Mulkey of LSU spoke out against what she called a sleazy journalist who she said is ready to hit piece. But most importantly, another issue. A bridge, a barge, like a boat, hit a bridge in Baltimore and several people died. Major crisis occurred. Mass casualty event in Baltimore. Anyways, this has been Lee Enochs. And I want to wish you a great Easter, a good Friday, a holy week. Above all, holy weeks in the history of humanity today. This has been Lee Enochs. God bless you. Have a great week with your family and friends. I hope you can come together this week with your family and have a great time. I love you all. This has been Lee Enochs celebrating the 60th episode of The Lee Enochs Show, America's most controversial podcast. I love you all. God bless you. Have a great day.